فعاش القلب إخلاصا وصرت تحومك الطير تحلق في ثقافات وتنهل من ربى الخير.
We commence by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sending blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his household, his companions. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless them and to bless every one of you and to bless us all and to grant humanity at large the goodness and the peace that we are searching for through the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My brothers, my sisters, I want to commence by declaring my love for you. It is only because we are connected in Allah that I am seated here or standing here in front of you today. So we have a link, and this link is created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we are taught that the best of human beings are those who are the best to the rest of the human beings. خَيْرٌ النَّاسِ أَنْفَعُهُمْ لِلنَّاسِ خَيْرٌ النَّاسِ أَنْفَعُهُمْ لِلنَّاسِ. The best of the people are those who are the most beneficial to the rest of the people. So remember, my brothers, my sisters, if you want to be the best, you need to reach out to everyone, inshallah. Today, I want to address you regarding something very important. Yesterday, I spoke at the stadium here, and I made mention of a man who was from Africa. Do you remember who I spoke about? Lukman, mashallah. It means you were either there or you were listening, mashallah. Lukman al-Hakim, he was from Africa. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned him in the Quran because he did something very good. What was it? He took care of his offspring. So if you take care of your offspring, Allah will bless you as well. Ibrahim alayhi salam, he took care of his offspring. Allah blessed him. With us, we need to realize that this man who was not a prophet of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about him in the Quran, and an entire surah is named after him. When you have something good, where did you get it from? Where did you get it from? Allah. He's the one who gives you goodness. So even if you're a wealthy person, even if you're a healthy person, if Allah wants, He can take away the wealth and the health. He can take away anything. So the giver is Allah. And this is why Allah says in the Quran, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا لُقْمَانَ الْحِكْمَةَ أَنِ اشْكُرْ لِلَّهِ وَمَنْ يَشْكُرْ فَإِنَّمَا يَشْكُرُ لِنَفْسِهِ. And remember when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah says, remember when we gave Luqman the wisdom. We gave Luqman wisdom. And what did we do when we gave him the wisdom? It was in order for him to be grateful to Allah, to be thankful to Allah. When you have been given a gift from Allah, you need to be thankful. If you show ingratitude, Allah will punish you, or Allah will take it away. Allah will take it away. And this is why when you have goodness, when you have the deen, when you have been blessed with iman, remember you need to cherish it. You need to value it. Because Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ أَنْتُمُ الْفُقَرَاءُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ هُوَ الْغَنِيُّ الْحَمِيدُ. Oh people, you are the ones who are in need of Allah. Allah does not need you, but you need Him. Allah is independent. Allah is all-able, all-powerful. It is you who needs Allah. He continues the very next verse after that. He says, إِن يَشَأْ يُذْهِبْكُمْ وَيَأْتِ بِخَلْقٍ جَدِيدٍ وَمَا ذَلِكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ بِعَزِيزٍ. If He wants, He can eradicate you, He can delete you, He can cause you to die, and He can replace you with another creation. He will replace you if He wants. And that's not difficult for Allah. That's what He says. So if we don't want to be replaced, we need to appreciate the gifts of Allah upon us. We need to worship Allah. We need to be behaving ourselves. We need to be people who are beneficial on earth. Understand why you are on earth. You are on earth in order to worship the one who made you during the short test period, which lasts approximately 70 years. That's why you are on earth. You are on earth to worship Him, and at the same time, if you want to worship Him, you need to acknowledge that He is the creator of everything around you. So you need to respect the rest of His creation. Allah made everything around us. You respect creation. You do not harm people. You do not harm animals. You do not harm birds. You do not destroy the environment or the ecosystem. Subhanallah. Causing unnecessary headache and pollution or destruction is against the very reason that you have been sent onto earth. Remember this. So you thank Allah, Allah will give you. If you don't thank Him, He takes it away from you. And sometimes, He may even punish you as a result. May Allah not do that to us. Say Ameen. My brothers and sisters, this man Lukman was so beautiful, so wise. He related the gift that Allah gave him to Allah. When he was wise, did he say, I am wise because I have a lot of experience, because I have a top brain, because my IQ is very, very high? No, he related it to Allah. There is another example in the Quran. At the time of the Prophet Moses, may peace be upon him, there was a man known as Qarun. Allah says, we gave him also, we gave him a lot, we gave him wealth.
إِنَّ قَارُونَ كَانَ مِنْ قَوْمِ مُوسَى فَبَغَى عَلَيْهِمْ وَآتَيْنَاهُ مِنَ الْكُنُوزِ مَا إِنَّ مَفَاتِحَهُ لَتَنُوءُ بِالْعُصْبَةِ أُولِي الْقُوَّةِ إِذْ قَالَ لَهُ قَوْمُهُ لَا تَفْرَحْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ الفرحين.
Allah says, indeed, Qarun was from the nation of Moses, may peace be upon him. But he reneged from them. He transgressed. He went beyond the limits. What did he do? Allah says, we gave him treasures, so much wealth that wealth itself was packed into huge treasures. And the keys, just the keys to his treasures, they were so many and so heavy that it was difficult for a group of very strong men to carry the keys only. That's what the Quran says. Imagine what type of wealth he must have had. What treasures he must have had. The keys are so heavy. Today, even if you own $10,000, to be honest, it's one small pile like this, you carry it in your pocket and you can move, right? Allah says, we gave him a lot. What was his crime? You know what his crime was? He removed Allah from the equation and he said, I got all of this because of my brain. I got all of this because I outsmart everyone. I am a top brain. I'm very witty. I'm a shrewd businessman, etc., etc. And he took Allah out of the equation. So Allah says, the crime was he related what we blessed him with to himself, not realizing if he says he used his brain to get what he got, who gave him the brain? How many people don't have a brain? How many people, when I say don't have a brain, I mean they are struggling and suffering when it comes to mental health. May Allah give them cure. Say Ameen. And may Allah grant cure to all those who are sick and ill in any way throughout the globe. Say Ameen. My brothers and sisters, Allah gave you the brain. Allah gave you the hands. Allah gave you the eyes. Allah gave you the nose. Allah gave you the tongue. Allah gave you the lips and the teeth. Allah gave you the movement. If Allah wants, wallahi, no matter how powerful you are, no matter how strong you are, no matter how much you have been exercising on a daily basis and going to the gym and doing whatever else, if Allah wants, one small nerve in your system can move out of place and cause paralysis, and you will not be able to move and you won't know what is wrong with yourself. That is Allah. That is the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So thank Allah that He has given you your eyes and your nose and your ears and your lips and every faculty that you have. Thank Him, and you have a brain and a mind and you have legs to walk. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless those who are immobile and grant them cure. Say Ameen. So my brothers and sisters, we need to relate everything we have to Allah. Today if you have wealth, yes, you might have used the brain that Allah gave you. You see how you relate it to Allah? That is called gratitude. It's called acknowledging. Someone taught you when you are young. As you grow older, you begin to go against them, themselves, not realizing that's my teacher, that's my ustad. Let me respect this particular teacher of mine at least. Subhanallah, they did good to me. So Allah says, هَلْ جَزَاءُ الْإِحْسَانِ إِلَّا الْإِحْسَانِ فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ. Is the recompense of goodness anything besides goodness? Which is it of the favors of your Lord do you deny, O mankind, O jinnkind? Remember my brothers and sisters, when someone does good, you do good back to them. But a better person is he who does good without someone doing good. Don't wait for someone to do good to you and say, they gave me something, I'll give them something. Do good before they have even done good to you. Look at Allah. Before we even worship Him, He already created us. We didn't even understand because our minds were not developed when we were in the wombs of our mothers. But we were born and we grew older and older. And then He says at the age of puberty, it is now your duty. You are known as mukallaf. Mukallaf meaning you are responsible to worship Allah, to look for Him, to search for Him, to ask questions no matter what they are, until you find your Maker and you only worship your Maker, none else. Whoever made me, I owe my worship to him. Whoever created me, I owe my worship to him. Whoever I'm going to return to when I die, I put my head on the ground and I said, oh you whom I'm going to return to when I die, have mercy upon me. That is called Islam. Subhanallah. So if you are thankful to Allah, Allah will give you in return. If you show goodness, you will have goodness. If you give goodness, you will have it. And when someone does good, you expect from them also that subhanallah, that goodness be acknowledged. They've done it, you recompense. When you do it, you expect that. The minimum is you are not harmed. You know, there was a time, a long time back, when mashallah, our friends were those who used to help us. Now, the world has become so material. When I say material, everything is about money. If I'm getting something from you, I'm your friend. If I'm not getting something from you, I don't need to even greet you. You know, we are taught if you want to spread love, you must greet. Salam. In Sierra Leone, they told me when I entered, first time in my life, I learned about this beautiful culture. They said, you have to put your window down and you have to wave at those who are there to greet you. I was surprised. To me, it's something new and different because normally we don't want to be arrogant or to show that, you know, I'm some big person, etc. No, we are nothing in the eyes of Allah. We are all equal. We are all the same. Maybe I'm worse than you. Who knows? May Allah forgive me and forgive you and grant us Jannah. Say Ameen.
Ameen.
So, as I waved at a few people, I noticed how happy the people were. They were so happy and delighted, subhanallah. I learned something and I told myself, subhanallah, look at how appreciative the people are, subhanallah. So I'm standing here in front of you, mashallah, tabarakallah. And I ask you to forgive my shortcomings. If I have said anything or if I have erred in a way that you might have felt hurt, forgive me. Because when you forgive, you achieve the forgiveness of Allah. If I had it my way, and if time, if the day had perhaps 100 hours and not just 24 hours, I might have had the time to shake everybody's hand and perhaps to speak to you in person. But you know we are just human beings. That you do with Allah. Talk to Him every day. Talk to Him 5 times a day. Talk to Him at night when people are sleeping. Subhanallah. Going back to my point, the hadith says, "Ala adullukum ala amrin idha fa'altumuhu tahababtum afshu salama baynakum." Should I not show you something that if you were to do it, love would spread between you? Greet each other with peace and make sure you understand the meaning of the greeting. What does it mean? Assalamu alaikum. May peace be upon you. In other words, I will not harm you. I will not harm you. You are at peace. You are at peace from me to begin with. We used to say friends are those who help you. Now, when we've become so material, we say friends are those who do not harm you. Wow. Wow. Friends are those who do not harm you. Because many people, they are ready to harm at any cost. The minute you achieve something, they want to see you down. If you are a true believer, you will be happy at the achievement of others. When you see someone achieving, you say, Alhamdulillah, MashaAllah.
وَلَوْلَا إِذْ دَخَلْتَ جَنَّتَكَ قُلْتَ مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ لَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ.
Even when you have achieved yourself, you need to say, MashaAllah, Tabarakallah. This is related to Allah. لا قوة إلا بالله. No strength, no power besides that of Allah. Allah is the one who gave me. So Luqman the wise, Subhanallah, he told his son a few things, pieces of advice. And I said yesterday, and I'm repeating it again, how many of us advise our children? How many of us spend time with our children and advise our children? How many of us advise our young siblings or even our brothers and sisters who are older than us? And even our parents, sometimes if you know that your father or your mother is making a mistake, it is very, very correct and it's your duty to respectfully correct them. Take a look at the Prophet Abraham. What did he tell his father?
Ya abati inni qad ja'ani min al-ilmi ma lam ya'tika fattabi'ni ahdika siratan sawiyya.
Oh my father, knowledge has come to me that did not come to you. So follow me and I will guide you to the right path. You are busy doing those things that will be resulting in the anger of Allah. You are worshipping the devil. So the son says,
Ya abati la ta'budi shaytan. Inna shaytan kana lirrahmani asiyya.
Oh my father, do not worship the devil, for indeed Satan was very, very transgressing against the most merciful. I am here with the same message to tell you, let's worship Allah. Let's not fall into the trap of the devil. Let's not become people who fall into the trap of Shaytan, Satan. My brothers and sisters, Allah loved the statement of Luqman alayhi salam. Luqman al-Hakim. Allah loved his statement so much. Allah says, remember when we gave Luqman the wise, the wisdom that he had, so that he can be grateful to Allah. For indeed, whoever is grateful for their own benefit. If you thank Allah for what you've got, who are you helping? You are helping yourself, to be honest, to acknowledge what Allah has given you. But if not, you are a loser. So what did he tell his son? I want to speak about a few of the points that Luqman the wise told his son. The first point he says,
Ya bunayya la tushrik billahi inna ash-shirka la dhulmun 'azim.
Oh my son, don't worship anyone, any deity besides your maker, for indeed that would be the greatest oppression. It would be the greatest wrong to worship someone who did not make you, who is not your creator. When you put your head on the ground, you need to say, glory be to the one who made me, my Rabb. Rabbun means creator, nourisher, cherisher, sustainer, provider, protector, and curer. All of that is included in the term Rabbun. Whoever you are, I put my head on the ground for you and you alone. And I worship you alone. And I will not worship any deities besides you. Subhanallah. So he's telling his son, worship Allah alone and don't engage in worshipping deities besides Allah. No matter who and what. You worship the Almighty, God Almighty, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whoever made you, we call him Allah. And Allah actually means the worshipped one. So he is the worshipped one because he deserves to be worshipped. He made me, that's why. Imagine the one who created you. What do you think his status would be? He deserves our existence. So that was the first piece of advice. And Allah makes mention of it because it is the most powerful piece of advice. And I'm starting also with the same piece of advice. My brothers, my sisters, purify your worship. Relate your goodness to Allah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us goodness. Then we have the second piece of advice, very important. I want to ask you a question. Allah created you, correct? Is that correct? But He chose someone through whom you were brought onto this earth. They are known as parents. Your mother, your father shall remain your mother and your father up to the end of time. Because who chose them? Allah. Did you choose your mother? No. Did you choose your father? No. Was there an application form prior to birth asking you, where do you want to be born? What type of a mother do you want? What family would you like? No. That already goes to show that man, we are not in control. Allah is in control. He has created us for a purpose because we didn't have a say as to how we were created, where we were created, and to whom we were born to. That's a sign that Allah decided. It's part of our test. It's like when you go into a school and you are writing your O levels, A levels, whatever other examinations you have, the senior secondary certificate. Do you decide the questions? No. You don't decide the questions. The examiner who has put you in the test will actually decide your questions. You cannot say, why do you have this question here? No. You either know it or you don't. Same applies. Allah put us on earth to test us. That's why He decided your environment and He decides the tests that you will go through. Because every human being will go through tests. And it's only those who understand who will be able to pass the test one after the other in this short life. So Lukman the wise says to his son, oh my son, Allah has asked us, Allah has advised us to be kind to our parents, no matter who they are. وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ. Indeed, Allah has advised us regarding our parents. Subhanallah. So my brothers and sisters, he's advised us to be kind to our parents. Kindness. How many of us are kind to our parents? How many of us are kind to our parents? We need to realize that your parents are a gift for you, even if they are not Muslim, even if they happen not to agree with your faith. You need to respect them and be kind to them. You need to understand that Allah chose them for you as a test. Your mother will remain your mother. You might not agree with some things that she might do or she might say, but or even what she might believe, but she's your mother. So you continue being kind to her. Your father is your father. You continue being kind to your dad. Subhanallah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless every one of us and to grant us goodness. My brothers and sisters, that was the second piece of advice regarding kindness to parents. Your parents, you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide you regarding your relationship with your parents. Remember that. No matter who you are, you can be a great man. You can be a leader in your own way. But your mother will remain your mother. You are still the baby of your mother, even if you are 70 years old. You are your mother's child. And you are your father's child as well. And this is why where there is divorce or where there is a problem between your mother and your father, you need to be careful. Very careful. Respect both of them. And if they talk bad about the other, you can excuse yourself by saying, Dad, please don't talk about my mom because that is my mom. That's all. I cannot side because you are both my parents. If your mom says something bad about your father because they are divorced, you say, my mom, I don't want to hear about my dad because you know what? My love for you is not connected to my love for my father. It's my love for you, you are my mother. Let's not contaminate it by speaking bad about someone you didn't get along with, but he's my father. Because divorce has increased. And many people after divorce, sadly, they are made to choose. Either you are with this side or you are with this side. You need to be clear and say, listen, don't make the child choose. Don't make the child choose. Be a person who is upright and allows the relationship, because Allah decided that you would be the child of both of them. May Allah guide us. May Allah help us. My brothers and sisters, it reminds me that divorce is on the increase across the globe. You know why? I've been studying this matter as a counselor for many years now. And I can tell you many people who get married don't know why they're getting married. They don't realize it, they don't think. Many people getting married, marry for the wrong reasons. If you marry someone just because of their looks, what will happen? Well, the hadith says, be careful. People marry for looks, people marry for money. People marry for status, and people marry for righteousness. Those who marry for righteousness are the most successful. Because if you marry only for looks, ooh, beautiful, I want to marry you. Okay, get married. Tomorrow you see someone looking even better. What happens? I divorce you, now I want to marry you. And the next day you see another one. Oh, forget about you. Now I divorce you, I want to marry you. It will not stop. Like a mobile phone, if you don't have discipline, every time there's a new mobile phone, you want the new one. You want the new one. And you know you cannot afford it. But your eyes are now focused upon the new one. And you are no longer happy with the phone that serves you. The same applies to cars. And the same applies to clothes. And so many other things where we become people who are upset with something that's good. Because we want something better. Not realizing, let's go back to gratitude. Thank Allah, I have someone, I married them. They are the mother of my children, the father of my children. They have sacrificed for me. They are living with me. They are actually doing so much for these children. Let me be loyal to them. Let me be faithful to them. Let me make them happy. Let me say words that will make them smile. Let me make this home a home filled with love rather than a home filled with chaos. Confusion. No one knows who's the mother, who's the father, because they are never there. Spend time with your children. Imagine Allah says, we ask you to be kind to your parents. But my brothers and sisters, we have another problem. What is it? Sometimes the parents are leading their lives in a way that they make it difficult for the children to be kind to them. It happens. Some parents are such that they disrespect their children. You know, you need to understand your child as well. You will have problems. You will face difficulty. Talk to the child. Speak to your children. Have a good communication. When there is a problem the child is going through, the child will look at you for guidance. The child will not look at the friends and all the others who might give them wrong guidance, but rather you as a parent, be responsible. Be kind to your children as well. Because if you would like respect, you need to give that respect. So I have also spoken today about how important it is not only to be kind to your parents, but to be dutiful unto your children as well. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all ease and goodness. Ameen. So my brothers and sisters, look at that piece of advice. When Allah mentions this in Surah Lukman, He does not say it for no reason. It is a valuable piece of advice. And it applies eternally to every one of us. We can use it. And we must. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says regarding Luqman the wise,
Ya bunayya aqimis salata wa'mur bil ma'ruf wanha 'anil munkar wasbir 'ala ma asabak inna dhalika min 'azmil umur.
O my son, establish your prayers, turn unto Allah, pray hard. Pray for goodness, pray for happiness, pray for contentment. Turn to Allah, pray for the sake of Allah. Not only the 5 daily prayers, but beyond that, seek from Allah. Seek guidance, seek help, not just for yourself, but for others as well. Reach them with your prayers. I've come to your country to pray for you too. May Allah bless you and grant you growth and strength. And may Allah protect you from disaster and calamity. Say Ameen. May Allah grant you growth, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make the rebuilding of the country even better than what it was before. Say Ameen. But you need to work towards it. You need to contribute to your country by being honest, upright, hardworking. and learn to care for everyone. Then you've contributed in a beautiful way. So pray and keep on praying. وَأْمُرْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. Lukman says, oh my son, when people are doing bad, you need to discourage them from bad. And when you see a good deed, encourage people to do good. Encourage good, enjoin that which is good. Remind people to do goodness. Tell someone, my brother, I think you should do this. My sister, perhaps if you do this, you will earn the pleasure of Allah. Keep talking about good things, because that is how you will earn the pleasure of Allah. How many of us talk about good things? We remind each other about good things. Don't get upset when someone reminds you about your duty unto Allah. They are only doing you a favor. And Allah will ask you about them. Allah will say, did we not send messengers to you to remind you about your duty unto us? The answer can never be no. It will always be yes, we heard them. Well, what did you do as a result? Well, you know what? We ignored them. That's not good enough. So this is why Allah says, when there is goodness, enjoin it. When there is evil and bad, go out of your way to make sure you discourage people from being bad, from being hurtful, from being evil. Make sure that you are not just a spectator when bad is happening. Say something about it. Say, Subhanallah, at least pray to Allah. And I can tell you, the hadith says, the weakest of the lot is the one, at least in his heart, he feels that it is bad. At least in his heart, he feels that it is bad. Sometimes we let bad happen such that we don't even guide the people. We don't even feel it in our hearts. Sometimes we are the perpetrators of it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us. May our standards of morality and our values be of a very high level. Ameen. Let's look at another piece of advice. He says, Ya bunayya, O my beloved son. O my beloved son. إنها إن تك مثقال حبة من خردل فتكن في صخرة أو في السماوات أو في الأرض يأتي بها الله. Oh my son, I want you to know that any deed you have done and anything, even if it is as small as a mustard seed. You know what is a mustard seed? If it is even as light as a mustard seed and it is hidden inside a rock, not underneath it, not on the top of it, inside the rock, Allah knows it. And even if it is anywhere in the heavens or the earth, Allah knows it. So my son, you can never hide from Allah. When you hide from mankind to commit a sin, you need to know your Creator is watching. He knows. Seek His forgiveness, amend your ways, and you will find goodness and happiness, joy and prosperity, because you are on the same page that the Almighty wants you to be upon. Allah is the owner. Allah is the owner of everything, the heavens and the earth and whatever lies between. So if you want the goodness, He's the owner of goodness. You better make friends with Him. If you want something and you have a friend, you know that that friend is going to give you, right? You have a friend and you need a favor. That friend will help you. If your friend is Allah, you don't need to worry about anything. Ala inna awliya Allahi la khawfun alayhim wa la hum yahzanun. Indeed, the friends of Allah. The friends of Allah. No fear upon them, nor do they need to be sad. How do I become a friend of Allah? The next part of the verse says, in fact, the next verse, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَكَانُوا يَتَّقُونَ. You only need two things. You need iman, belief, and taqwa, which is righteousness, piety, God consciousness. If you want to become a friend of the Almighty, you need to believe in Him, number one. And number two is, you need to be righteous. Be steadfast. Don't allow your whims and fancies to overtake you. Because then you will go to the nightclub, you will go to the casinos, you will go to the pubs and bars, you will go to the places of drugs and sin. But if you are righteous, you lead a clean life, very clear. Your money that you earn with your sweat, you will not waste it. on a nightclub. You will not waste it in intoxicants. Why? Because you fear Allah. You are a righteous man. You will have that money. You can use it and you can be charitable with it. Subhanallah. Why waste it? It's a gift of Allah. So my brothers and sisters, don't waste the money you have. When you are spending, think hard. What am I spending upon? What is this? Is it in the pleasure of Allah or not? Is it needed or not? Can I afford it or not? Should I have it or not? Answer all those questions and then you decide whether you actually need it or not. Whether it's going to be worth your while and your money to actually have that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us barakah and blessings in our wealth. Say ameen. MashaAllah, that was a very loud ameen. I see that. Alhamdulillah. So my brothers and sisters, these are the teachings. You cannot hide from Allah. You can never hide from Allah. So now what do we do? What do we do? We've already committed sins. We've already done so much of bad. We've already been on the wrong path. Well, it's never too late. قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. Verse 53, Surah Zumar. Allah says, O Muhammad, peace be upon him, tell my worshippers who have committed sin against themselves, who have done wrong, who have transgressed, never lose hope in the mercy of Allah. He will forgive all your sins. He will forgive every single sin, for indeed, He is most forgiving, most merciful. What is required? You need to admit your sin, number one. There are four conditions. Number one, admit your sin. To whom? To Allah. You don't have to confess to me. No, I could be a bigger sinner than you. Remember that. So what you have to do, you confess to Allah and Allah alone. You, no one needs to know about what your sin is. Don't disclose it. No one. Zero. You just say, oh Allah, I admit what I've done is wrong. You admit it. Number two, you regret it. Oh Allah, I regret it. I feel I shouldn't have done this. I was wrong. Regret. Number three, ask Him for forgiveness. Oh Allah, You are my maker. You are my owner. You are my king. You are my savior. You who has made me. You are the one through whom I shall enter paradise. Through Your mercy. You are the savior of mankind at large. Oh maker of mankind. You have made me. So save me and save mankind at large. Forgive me, oh Allah. You are the owner of forgiveness. Al-Ghaffar, Al-Ghafoor. The most forgiving, the most merciful, Allah. Subhanallah. So you want the mercy of the most merciful. You ask Him directly for mercy and for forgiveness. He owns you. No one else owns you. Remember that. No one can claim authority over you in terms of forgiveness besides Allah. He is your Rabb. He's the one who made you. So you say, oh you who made me, I repent to you. What I have done was wrong. Deliver me from evil. Grant me protection. You are my protector. Who is your protector? He who made you, Allah. He who made you. And the fourth condition is, you promise never to do that again. So what you do, you say, oh Allah, I'm not going to go back. I'm not going to go back into my sin. If you have met all those four conditions, we are guaranteed by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, no matter what you've done, you are totally forgiven. He says, "At-ta'ibu min adh-dhanbi kaman la dhanba lah." The one who seeks forgiveness from a sin is equivalent to the one who has no sin at all. Allahu Akbar. Right now, right here, let's all seek the forgiveness of Allah. Oh Allah, forgive our sins. Oh Allah, forgive our sins. Amen. We admit to you, oh Allah, forgive our sins. Amen. We regret, oh Allah, forgive our sins. Amen. We promise not to do it again, forgive our sins. Amen. Now that we've promised Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let's change our habits. Let's change our ways. Let's become regular with our duty unto Allah. Wallahi, you will see the mercy of Allah in your life today, not tomorrow. Now, you will see the mercy of Allah already. You will witness the peace and tranquility in your heart, in your life. Because you are now on the same page with your Maker, the one who made you, He who nourishes, cherishes, sustains, provides, protects and cures. Subhanallah. So my brothers and sisters, remember we have turned to Allah. Don't spoil your sheet. Don't spoil your sheet by committing sin again. We won't do it. And if for some reason Shaytan, the devil, comes to you, if for some reason the devil comes to you and he makes you sin again, what do? You repent again. You repent again and again and again. No problem. On condition that when you repented, you did not plan at that moment to commit the sin again. Perhaps the committing of the sin came later on. You thought of it and you might have fallen into the trap once again. Get up and walk again. Even if it happens as many times as can be, don't lose hope in the mercy of Allah. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. Ask Allah's forgiveness once, twice, thrice. Allah gets so happy when someone seeks His forgiveness. The third time, Allah tells His angels, do you see this worshipper? He has now realized that he has a Rabb, a creator, a maker. He has realized he has someone he's going to return to, the supreme deity, he who made him. This worshipper of mine is seeking forgiveness from me for a third time, in such a way that I know he has now realized he has someone who can either forgive him or punish him. For that, I want you, O angels, to bear witness that he is totally forgiven. That's the mercy of Allah. عَلِمَ عَبْدِي أَنَّ لَهُ رَبًّا يَأْخُذُ بِالذَّنْبِ وَيَغْفِرُهُ أُشْهِدُكُمْ أَنِّي غَفَرْتُ لَهُ. That's the Arabic part of what I just said earlier. There can be no one more merciful than Allah. Islam is a religion based on mercy, based on redemption. We have a personal savior in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is a personal savior. He shall deliver us from all evil. It is Allah and Allah alone. So that is amazing, because we are taught that your sin is your secret between you and your maker. No one needs to know about it. You know, your maker knows. Wipe it out by seeking his forgiveness and become a newborn. Subhanallah. My brothers and sisters, when you get close to Allah, what are the signs? When you become close to Allah, it starts showing in you as a person. What are the signs? Your nature is softened. You become a person who looks at others with compassion and love, because you realize, who gave me life? Gave all this life. He is the king. If he did not want, he would not have given everyone else life. But because he gave them life, I need to treat his given life with utmost respect. When you see animals, when you see creatures, when you see trees, when you see anything, the ecosystem, remember what is created by Allah, it's part of your test. How are you going to treat these things? It's part of your test, subhanallah. So that is Allah. He's asking us to pass the test by acknowledging that He is the maker. He did not only make you, but He made with you an entire creation, so that He tests you with the creation. Many of us fail. We see people, we ignore them. We don't want to help them. When someone is drowning, everyone goes and takes a photo of that person. Hey, let me take a selfie, drowning. Do this, and we're taking a selfie. You are supposed to jump in and help them. Forget about your photos, it can happen later on. Subhanallah. Everything has changed today. Let's go back to the original teachings. Let's become human beings to begin with. Let us become human beings to begin with. Let us learn to care for one another. Humanity at large, let us learn to build, not to destroy. Let us learn to contribute positively, not negatively. Let us learn to mend and not to damage. My brothers and sisters, it's a powerful message of Islam. Powerful message. This was the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah strengthen us. May Allah grant us goodness. May Allah grant us ease. May Allah grant us protection. May Allah bless every one of us. May Allah grant us Jannatul Firdaus. Then Lukman tells his son, Oh my son,
لا تصعر خدك للناس ولا تمشي في الأرض مرحا.
Don't turn your cheek in arrogance for the people. And don't walk on earth in a haughty manner, in a proud way. Don't be proud and arrogant, no matter who you are. You are just a slave of Allah. Don't be proud and arrogant on earth. Don't walk in a way with your nose stuck up into the air. لا تصعر خدك للناس. Don't turn your cheek. You see people and you turn away, like you're ignoring them, as though you don't even want to greet. Learn to greet people. If you greet, you will be able to spread love. That was the hadith I mentioned earlier. Should I not show you something? If you were to do it, love would spread between you. He says, spread the greeting. Greet each other. You greet each other. This is what I noticed in Sierra Leone. Everyone is greeting, mashallah. Everyone is greeting. From the time I landed, everyone is excited. Subhanallah. That is the love. It's a sign of love. When you greet each other, it's a sign that you love each other. When you stop greeting each other, you need to be worried. That is why when you pass one another, greet each other. Beautiful greeting. Assalamu alaikum. And smile. Peace be upon you. Peace be upon you. Imagine everyone telling everyone else, peace be upon you. Do you think we will ever suffer with war? No. We will be spreading peace, but sometimes we are hypocrites. We say assalamu alaikum, but we have hatred in our heart. We have jealousy, envy. We have malice, dirt in the heart, bad feelings for this brother or this sister. Why? Remove it, because the Prophet Muhammad says, لا يدخل الجنة من كان في قلبه مثقال حبة من خردل من كبر صلى الله عليه وسلم. He will never enter paradise in whose heart is even a mustard seed's weight worth of pride. So the Sahaba, the companions asked him, O Messenger, we love our clothing and our conveyance, etc., etc. He said, that's not what I'm talking about. Pride is when you despise people and when you reject the truth. When you know what the truth is and you reject it, that is pride, arrogance. And when you despise people, when you think people are small and you are big, that is pride. If you have the best car and the best house and the best clothing and the best perfume and the best of everything, that is not a sign of direct pride. No way. But if your attitude has changed in a bad way, then that is pride. You find some people, they own half of a town, half of a city. But when he comes in the masjid, no one even knows who he is. He just walks like everyone else, subhanallah. He's humble, but he has the best car, the best house, everything. He uses what Allah gave him to help people. It doesn't mean if I'm humble, I must hide my money and I mustn't even buy a car that I need. No, you can do, but your attitude is what makes you arrogant. Be careful. No matter how handsome you are, your attitude can make you ugly. And no matter what you think you may be looking like, some people think I'm not that good looking. Wallahi, your attitude can make you the most beautiful person on earth. The most beautiful. So if you want beauty, you need to develop goodness in attitude. Remember that. This advice, we get it from Lukman. It's in the Quran. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has repeated that for us. Don't turn your cheek against people. Don't be arrogant. You greet someone, they don't greet you back. No problem. You got the reward. They didn't. Subhanallah. You know how important it is to greet in Islam? You know how important it is to reply the greeting? The reply is more important than the greeting itself. Did you ever know that?
وَإِذَا حُيِّيتُم بِتَحِيَّةٍ فَحَيُّوا بِأَحْسَنَ مِنْهَا أَوْ رُدُّوهَا إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ حَسِيبًا.
When you are greeted with a greeting, reply it with a better greeting, or at least equate it. Someone says, peace be on you. You say, may the peace of Allah be upon you and His blessings and His mercy. Wow, I greeted you back in a bigger way. Subhanallah. That is the mercy of Allah. So Allah says, when you are greeted, greet back with a better greeting. If not, at least a similar greeting. Because Allah takes a record of everything. He will record that you didn't greet back, or you greeted back, or you greeted in a better way. Subhanallah. Imagine just a greeting. Let's not take it for granted.
greet each other, smile at each other. I've been speaking about this for a long time, and I promise you, repeating it makes a difference. Makes a very big difference. You'll see a marked improvement in your lives. And what was the last piece of advice of Luqman mentioned in this surah? He says,
وَلَا تَمْشِ فِي الْأَرْضِ مَرَحًا إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ كُلَّ مُخْتَالٍ فَخُورٍ وَقُصِدْ فِي مَشْيِكَ وَاغْضُضْ مِنْ صَوْتِكَ.
He says, don't be proud and arrogant, because Allah does not like those who are proud and arrogant. We spoke about that. He says, lower your voice. Walk humbly, moderation. Waqsid fi mashyik. When you walk, walk like a normal human being. You don't have to tip your toes as though you are now bigger than everybody else. You don't have to rush in a way that you will fall down. And you don't have to be so slow as though people will think you are loitering. But you must be balanced. That's the teaching of Islam. Balance in everything. When you eat, you cannot have all your food today and then break for 1 week. No. Relax. You need to eat 2-3 times a day. Space it out. You don't have to be greedy. Eat as much as you need. Some people live to eat. And all of us are supposed to be eating to live. There is a very big difference between the two. Some people, their whole life rotates around food, 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 and that's it. And they waste, and they eat, and they eat, and they continue eating. How much are you going to eat? You know, one day I was speaking about destiny, and I said, every morsel has been written. How many kilos of vegetables you are going to have, or meat, or eggs, it's written. So say your quota from Allah prior to your death was 25,000 eggs in your life. I don't know if I'm being ridiculous, but I'm just giving you an example, okay? The more eggs you eat every day, the quicker you are getting to your death. Have you heard what I just said? Which means your quota is over. So rather, take it easy, relax. I'm eating slowly but surely. Now, you might want to understand that there are different ways of understanding what I just said. But what I am trying to say is, don't be greedy. Your food is not going to run away. Your last morsel, you will have it. No one else will eat it. If Allah wrote it for you, you will eat it before you die. Don't worry. اعلم أن نفسا لن تموت حتى تستكمل رزقها. You should know that no soul shall die until it has received in full the sustenance that Allah wrote for it. So if Allah wrote you the last grain of rice, you will have to pick it and eat it before you die. What I'm trying to say is, let's not be greedy. What's for you is going to come to you. Let's reach out to others also. We are taught as Muslims, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if you are a true believer, when you are cooking your stew, you will add a little bit more water and you will send a little bit to your neighbors so that they do not sleep hungry. Allahu Akbar! Your neighbors, non-Muslim neighbors, your Prophet is telling you, when you are cooking food, nice food, make a little bit more and send them some, subhanallah, so that they do not sleep hungry. That is a powerful statement, because it means whatever you have, share it with others, no matter who they are, so that they do not suffer not having had what you had. Especially if it is a necessity, like food and drink and shelter and clothing. Subhanallah, this is Islam. Where are we? What are we doing across the globe? Where are these teachings? May Allah help us to reach out to people. They see the goodness of this beautiful faith. And wallahi, they will respect Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before anyone else. Say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah's peace and blessings be upon him, upon all the other messengers, and upon every one of us. Ameen. So he says, oh my son, don't walk in an arrogant fashion. And lower your voice. When you talk, don't scream. No need to scream. Subhanallah. Don't yell at people. That's what it's meant. You swear people. You yell at them. You disrespect them. You know, when you see people arguing, the two are standing next to each other, but they are shouting and pointing like they are crazy. Allah says, don't do that. It's the advice of Luqman. Why? Listen to the last verse in that piece of advice. إِنَّ أَنْكَرَ الْأَصْوَاتِ لَصَوْتُ الْحَمِيرِ.
Indeed, the most detested sound is the sound of a braying donkey. Have you ever heard a donkey making a noise? It's so loud, it's so irritating, and you don't know what is being said. You don't understand anything. So if two people are arguing and they are yelling at the top of their voices, they are both fools. The reason is, no one knows what they are saying. Neither of them know what is being uttered. And the spectators, they look at both of them as fools.
May Allah protect us. Imagine this beautiful advice. My brothers and sisters, today I've chosen a more specialized talk, in the sense that we touched on specifics: worship of Allah, development of character, respect of parents, developing relationships with our children so that we can guide them, and we can build the nation so that in future we can have children who will be leaders by the will of Allah, because we cared for them and we empowered them and we educated them and we treated them fairly and we respected them. This is Allah, subhanallah. And we spoke about how important it is to pray and to reach out, and we spoke about how important it is to lower our voices and to protect ourselves from arrogance and pride, to respect all people, to greet one another. So many things we have taken a lesson regarding today. I hope and I pray that my presence here is accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I pray that your presence is also accepted. May we get up from here forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the angels would actually be saying, whenever we have gathered in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or in a gathering remembering Allah, Allah remembers us. The angels surround us with the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the mercy descends upon us. And when we get up, we are told, get up, you are totally forgiven. So inshallah, when we leave here, we are forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We start a new leaf. We quit our bad ways. We cut out all the sins we've been committing for so many years. We start working on our relationships with our spouses, with our family members, with our parents and children, etc., etc. We need to make sure we make amends. We need to make sure we build relationships. Don't destroy small matters. Forgive them. Excuse the people. Life is too short to hold a burden. When you don't forgive, you are holding a rock on your shoulder. You have many, many more rocks as you don't forgive everyone else. The day you forgive, you find you feel so good because you no longer have those rocks and boulders on your shoulders. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless this nation. Oh Allah, we ask you to grant us goodness. Oh Allah, we ask you to grant us mercy. We ask you to bless us in every way. Grant cure to those who are sick and ill. Grant rahmah and mercy to those who passed away. Help those who are affected by the floods and the mudslides, Ya Allah. Help those, give them Jannatul Firdaus, those who passed away. And those who have remained, make it easy for them, Ya Allah. Those who are suffering in any way, grant them ease in their suffering, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, grant this nation growth and strength, Ya Allah. And all the nations, Ya Allah, grant us peace and stability across the globe, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, help us to worship you and you alone, Ya Allah. Help us to develop a connection with you and you alone, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, help us and become pleased with us, Ya Allah, such that the day we die, you grant us paradise, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, we ask you the goodness Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked. And we seek protection from the evil he sought protection from. Antal musta'an alayka al-balagh. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi al-aliyy al-azim. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifuhum. Wa salamun ala al-mursaleen. Wa alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi. Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayka.